So before we begin our worship service, I want to talk a little bit, just for a couple of minutes, about our new series of Bible studies that will begin not this week, but next week, the first full week of October, starting October 4th. We have some Bible studies scheduled to meet on Sunday, some that will be meeting on Wednesday, some meeting on Thursday. If you haven't signed up yet, or you have signed up and don't know what group you're in, you can talk to me after the worship service, or email me or phone me during the week. We have the version of the Bible that we'll be using, which is called the Immersive Reading Bible. It's the whole New Testament in the New Living Translation. And we'll all be using the same book that gives us the ability to really work together as teams and supporting each other in the Bible studies that we'll meet. So we have copies of this, plenty of copies for everyone that signed up, and even a couple of copies left over. So grab your copy, one for each person, both husband and wife and a couple. You can both have your separate copy. And they're on the worship center on your way out this morning, or you can come in during the week and pick one up, or you can call me at the church or at my cell phone during the week, and I will bring one to you. But one way or the other, we want everyone to have a copy of this week, because there's a little reading assignment. You're going to read ahead a little bit in the Gospel of Luke. So when you have your very first session together, you actually have some Bible reading that you've done, and you can talk about what you understand the message of the Gospel of Luke is, as well as have an opportunity to share any questions that you'd have. So I want you to pick up a copy today if you're all interested in being part of one of our groups. And if you don't know what group you're in, let us know, and we can take care of that today or early this week. So let's begin with prayer and invite God to be the overcoming, overpowering God that He is. And God, we face so many challenges in life, and every day seems to be just, again, challenges and barriers, and we're exhausted by halfway through the day. People tell us there's all sorts of good reasons for that. We just know that we don't like it. But we do like You, and we do like the fact You continue to give us Your energy and Your love and to give us Your hope. And so this morning, we join together, and as we join together, we want to energize each other. We want to be filled with the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. We want You to be a blessing to the people behind me who will be leading us in worship. May they feel Your presence taking care of them and taking care of us through their ministry. And as we look into Your scriptures and in Your desire for us this morning, may we sense that You are reaching to each one of us deep down into the very core of who we are and calling us to be all that You intended us to be through the power of Jesus Christ at work in us. Thank You for this morning, and we give You our praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. worship the Lord. Father, we thank you that you have called us to be worshipers of you. Today, just focus our minds on you. Just take away all the things that are distracting us, all the concerns of the day, because there are a lot of them. Just help us to focus on you during this time so we can give you praise and we can receive from you the word that you have for us. Amen.
Amen.
Keep Me in the Moment by Jeremy Camp. So when we get to the chorus, sing it, Oh Lord, keep me in the moment. Help me live with my eyes wide open, because I don't want to miss what you have for me. Go ahead and sing along with us on that.
Passing me, I just don't know. I've been thinking about family.
about heaven and the promise you hold. So it's all eyes on you until the day you call me home.
There were times when the Lord said, hey, when everything's going great, you're doing good, then you're all about me. But when you're struggling, when times are hard, what about that? And I think we're in those moments right now where we need to ask Jesus to walk alongside of us, carry us through these tough times with a smile on our face, joy in our heart, spring in our step, because he is the one that's going to keep us in this moment and give us what he has for us during this time. We would like to open up the altars this morning. Some of you are very familiar with coming to the altar. I've been doing that since I was a little girl. Some of us have been to the altar for a long time. It's a place of renewal, refreshing, renewal, a place where somebody can grab you by the arm or stand beside you and lift you up. So we ask you to come this morning and ask Father God to draw us close. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. Lay it all down again to hear you say, I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else take your place.
You may be seated. Is that better, George? Somehow they always work better when they're turned on. So it's a glory as well as a joy to be with you this morning. I just want you to know what a precious thing it is to not just to gather generically with Christian people, but to gather together with you and to experience God in our presence, calling us to continue to believe that, as always, God is bigger than us. And God wants us to be wants the us of tomorrow to be bigger than the us of us what we were yesterday. That we can be spiritually stronger, more equipped, more relaxed, more effective. Well, that's sermon number one. That's not even in my notes. Here's what I want to share that's in my notes. And that is, some of you I think know that I come from another Christian tradition, that I'm not a lifelong Free Methodist. And so one of the ways I work through that and make sure that I'm the best possible pastor for you is I'm taking a class right now designed to teach me how to be a good Free Methodist. And I think it's working. I hope it's working. But what it's doing, along with just some great interaction with the teacher and the fellow students, give me confidence of how to be the best possible pastor for y'all. But for me, the bigger thing that it's doing is it's kind of driving down into me something that's been going on for the last 3 or 4 years anyway, and that is to rethink the whole idea of religious labels. Rethinking the whole idea of religious labels. So more and more I try to identify myself as a Jesus follower. The label that we've used for a long time is still a good label in and of itself, but so much baggage has been thrown onto it, and that is the word Christian. I am a Christian. I'm part of a Christian group. I'm part of a Christian calling. But I'm trying to use the phrase more and more, I'm a Jesus follower. One of the reasons is that that label has been filled with so much thoughts from the non-Christian world that I just don't accept as true for me. And so, for instance, if you were to go to Google, or 100th of you might go to Bing instead, if you were to go to Google, your favorite search bar, and type in the phrase, why are Christians so, you wouldn't find that the completion for that is loving, wonderful, and God-filled. What you would find is, the internet thinks that the phrase, why are Christians so, ends up with the words, why are Christians so angry? Why are Christians so judgmental? Why are Christians so bigoted? The internet asks. And of course, the classic one, why are Christians so hypocritical? Now, the hypocritical is probably more true than I want to admit. I don't like that, and I'm always working at being authentic. But the other ones, you know, that's not how I want to be identified. The word Christian has a rich history, but it's been turned into a label, not even a good label. The reason I like that saying I'm a Jesus follower is it gets beyond the label to an action. There is an action that's a part of my everyday life, a bunch of actions, of consciously trying to align myself with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that I am following Jesus. And when Jesus moves, I try to move. And when Jesus says it's time to stop and take a rest by this green meadow and the still waters, I try to take a rest. I tell you, it's harder for me to take the rest than it is to move. But I try to do both. And so the word Christian is still accurate if you understand it. But today's world, you know, I just like to say to people, I'm a Jesus follower. And by the way, I think you should be a Jesus follower too. Maybe you're Christian, maybe you're not, maybe you've always thought you're a Christian and never thought much about it. or maybe you're delighted that you've never ever been a Christian, then any category of the Christian label, I would hope that you would be a Jesus follower too. And so today I just want to share with you, you know, why should you follow Jesus? And the Bible text that lays out the big mega reasons why we should follow Jesus is Colossians 1, chapter verses 15 to 23. The Son, Jesus Christ, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Christ all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Jesus is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Well, and he is the head of the body, the church, which is the beginning, and he is the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased for all his fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out by the gospel. So this is God's word for us this morning. This is the invitation to follow Jesus. And the first really good reason, and this is actually a reason that a lot of us who've been part of the church all of life don't think about very much, but this text is wonderful because it says, reminds us that we should follow Jesus because Jesus created us. And we always think, oh, well, God created us, and then Jesus showed up a long time afterwards. But this text says, no, Jesus Christ, in ways that we don't quite understand it, that he's part of God, he's fully a part of God, and since Jesus Christ is fully part of God, it was Jesus that created us. We're created through him, by him, and for him. Verse 16, in Christ all things were created, everything. And then it gives a long list. And it says, all those things were created through him, by the power of his word, and by the power of his love, and the power of his truth, and also for him. We're the whole purpose. Jesus, rather, is the purpose for which you and I were created. And so he created everything. Then later on it says, you know, one of the reasons that Jesus was involved in our creation was that he might be supreme over everything. More important, more valuable, more beautiful, more effective, more authoritative than anything else. And so here's what I want to say is that the Bible message begins not with the fact that you're a lousy person, or even with the fact that you're a good person. The Bible message begins with God created the world, and he created you with a perfect design in his mind and in his heart. And that the very first picture that we have of the created world, it is indeed a perfect world. It's perfect in beauty. Our pictures of the Garden of Eden, what we know about it, and what we've heard about it, and what we read about it, it was a beautiful place to be. It was just wonderful. It was wonderful weather-wise. There was all these beautiful varieties of green that God put into the plants and the vegetation. All the animals somehow did what the animals were supposed to do. And for the first little while, we don't know how long, for the first little while, even the humans there did what they were supposed to do, which means that not only was there beauty, there also was harmony. Everyone doing their part, everyone being appreciative of the other people who were doing their parts. We didn't have people bickering or people saying, that's mine, no, it's mine. There weren't people accusing other people. They were all living in harmony. Beauty beauty, harmony, and then sufficiency. When God created the world in his perfect design, it just wasn't to be something that was pretty where people got along with each other, but it was a world where everyone's needs were taken care of through the natural flow of the God-built, God-designed perfect system. And you can go through the Psalms, for instance, and the Psalms talk about how in God's perfect design, there's always the right water, and the water's always in the right place. And every plant has what it needs, every animal has what it needs, every society has what it needs. And so the Bible's message begins with God creating a perfect world, perfect beauty, perfect harmony, and perfect sufficiency. Everybody has whatever it is that they need. You know, we kind of resonate with that. Everyone does in their own way, but the story of the Garden of Eden, whether you believe it was really a true thing or just a myth, you know, there's something about people that there's deep wired in our DNA, in our basic operating system. There is the sense that we had a perfect origin and a hope that maybe there's something that could happen to us that would make the world perfect again and make me perfect again. Our outcry against the current reality, against ugliness, against injustice, and against inadequacy, all those flow from that basic DNA that says there is perfection in God's design, and we're not meeting that right now. We want to restore the world to that perfect design. And that's where the Bible story begins, literally, back in Genesis. The very first verses of the Bible is God creates the world perfectly, and there was perfect beauty, harmony, and sufficiency. But of course, the reality is that's not what we see around us now. Most of us would rather blame others than admit our own part of that, which is why we need Colossians 1:21. It says that the problem is not just that the world's gone wrong, but that we are alienated. Verse 21, once, for some of us it may still be true, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your mind because of your evil behavior. And I like to put it this way, because I think this is true for more of us than some of the other ways we can talk about being alienated from God, is a lot of us just assumed. Well, I think all of us, really. All of us at some point just assumed we really did need God. I can make my own decisions. You know, I don't need God's wisdom. I'm smart enough on my own. It's just my life, and it's only affecting me. I'm not hurting anybody else. And so I can make my own decisions. I don't need God to interfere or to help. I don't need his wisdom. We say, you know, really, I can accept my own limitations. There are some things I just can't do. So don't ask me to help you because that's one of the things I just can't do. Don't ask me to change because I just can't do. And in that way we're assuming this, that I don't need to ask God for help. I don't need to ask God for his wisdom, but also don't need to ask him for his help. I just live with my limitations as being a human, and I handle that. I accept that. We assume that I can enforce my own expectations. Now, this is for the type A people out there who always know exactly what's right for you and for everybody else. And you feel it's very important that you let everyone around you know your expectations for them. Not sensing the need to tolerate God's other creatures. So we just assumed that we didn't need God, that we could handle life on our own, that we could, it was our job to accept our limitations, and that whatever we expected other people to do, we could put the pressure on them to do that. So what I want to say is alienation is not just a word that's about really evil people who've done really bad things. Those people are alienated, of course, but the rest of us are too. Alienation is every time I act as if God is really not important to the world he created. Alienation is every time I act as if God is not really important to the world he created. And that's pretty much the world I grew up in. Maybe there was a time 60 years ago or 600 years ago when everyone lived in an attitude that we really need God and we want to work in harmony with God. But as far as long as I've been alive, and I've got these gray hairs to prove, it's been more than 2 or 3 years. As long as I've been alive, there's been this thought that God's really not necessary, at least in some parts of my life. The Bible calls that alienation. It cuts us off. It separates us from the power of God and from the ability to function in his perfect design. So I have a friend named Dell. Dell was, most of the time he was a great holiness preacher and a great lover of people and a great thinker. Every once in a while, kind of all that flew out the window. And he just did the craziest things, and they were always hilarious, but he also reaped the consequence. And so I'm standing with Dell out in the parking lot of the college that we worked at. We're both teachers there. So it's after work, it's been a long week, I think it's Friday night, and we're just kind of sitting there, we're kind of watching the life go by, and being glad that we don't have to face any more students for the next 36 hours. And as we're watching, I notice there's this little puff of smoke comes out of the front of Dell's car, sitting about 50 feet away in the parking lot. A little puff of smoke. And I asked Dell, I said, you know, Dell, is it normal that every Friday afternoon there's a little puff of smoke that comes out of the front of your car, your engine? And he says, what do you mean? And he turns around and he looks, and he starts off running, and he gets halfway to his car, and it just bursts into flame. Now, this is not the actual car, it's a reenactment. It just bursts into flame. And so he steps back. We call the fire department, they come and they extinguish it. But of course, by the time they get there, the whole engine compartment, especially all of the wiring harness, and it's all just shot. The car's totaled. Dell gets an insurance check and gets a new used car. And so I asked him about it. I said, you know, do you have any idea what went wrong? And he said, well, yesterday we had fun. We went out going over through the fields, and I just assumed my car could ford all those creeks that we went across. I just assumed my car could go over all those, down and under and through all those creeks we went across. I said, you know, did you ever think about all the computers in your engine compartment and all the wiring? He said, I just assumed that it would work. You know, the problem with when we assume things and we act upon it, we can't cut ourselves off from the consequences of those actions. We can assume things and we can act on things, we can't separate ourselves from the consequences. And I tell the story of Dale Covington's car because I like to tell stories about cars going into flames. But the other reason I tell the story is that it's a good metaphor for me. A lot of times there's things we assume about God and his interaction with the world. And we just assume that God's really not that important, God's not that interested, or we assume that God's not that able. And so we're going to have to kind of slog it out on our own in this particular circumstance. And we assume that we can act on whatever assumption that we want. But when we assume the wrong things, we can't separate ourselves from the negative consequences. And so this passage is saying when we were alienated because we assumed we didn't need God, it separates us from the perfect plan and our ability to be part of it. We suffer pain. We suffer the lack of connection and the lack of benefits of connection to who God is. So the very first big picture is I think you should follow Jesus because Jesus has a great plan, a great design, and only by following Jesus can you be part of that and have a sense of it, both for now and forever. But the second reason is one of the really interesting things about this passage. It's kind of tucked away in verse 17. But I want you to follow Jesus because Jesus sustains you as well as having created you. He created you, and now it says, verse 17, in Christ all things hold together. Oh, wow, that is a powerful verse. Now, those involved in looking at things in terms of the whole cosmos and the universe. They said this is one of the most important verses in all the Bible, because it talks about what holds things together. And things are being held together. They're falling apart too, but there is a force that holds things together. And here we find the force that holds things together is Jesus Christ. In other words, Christ didn't create the world just to see it fall apart and say, that's too bad, I'll just go make another one. He created the world, but also every day he's consciously, intentionally, vigorously holding it together. Book of Revelation shows what happens when just for a little bit, Jesus stops the action of holding things together, and we find that the world just kind of rips apart at the seams. Jesus is consciously, intentionally, continually, vigorously holding our world together. In our COVID-dominated, fire-streaked world, I think we all feel like we're falling apart. If you're not, God bless you. Please put on a seminar. Help us to enter into that state with you. But the rest of us, it's just really tough. And people this morning have already talked about that. COVID-dominated, fire-streaked world. We feel like we're falling apart. And I would say we need Jesus more than ever before. He's not less relevant. He's more necessary. Now, I thought about, what does sustaining mean? The idea that God sustains the world, that he holds it all together. And I thought, well, some illustrations. Maybe it's more like kind of like divine duct tape. You know, duct tape holds things together when they want to fall apart. And I thought, well, maybe no. Maybe it's more like a religious rubber band that you can put around two things and it holds them together. And I thought that's maybe not the best either. But these are all give little clues. Maybe it's like cosmic glue. The cosmic glue, super glue that holds everything together. But what it really means is that he never gives up. Jesus never gives up. He never gives up on the world, in the big world, but he also never gives up on you. He never gives up on the world. He never gives up on his perfect design. He never gives up on the idea that you could be more part of the perfect design as opposed to the imperfection in the world than what you are today. Every day we can be more like him and reflect more of his design. Now, to be clear, to be honest, disclaimer, the world might fall apart, but you don't need to fall apart with it. That's what it means to have Christ on the inside, is that when the things around us are falling apart, we don't need to fall apart with it. Our internal peace is no longer dictated by our external turmoil or peace. Things go up and things go down, and there is a certain sense of joy and peace that we have every day because our emotional state is more controlled by our fellowship with Christ, the fact that we follow Jesus, than anything else. And so at this point, as a sustainer, if we were to interact with the sustainer and really take Jesus up and holding the world together, it means that we can allow him to hold us. We can allow him to hold us. When I feel all the people around me are all trying to pull me in different ways, which is most of the time, I can take a 10-minute break, sustainment break, I can take a 10-minute break and say, Jesus, just hold me together. Let me know that I belong to you, and what is the one thing I can do to make you happy, and I'll do that, and the people can handle that one way or the other. A 10-minute break just to say, Jesus, hold me together. When I feel like the economy or that my health or the coronavirus is pulling me apart, I can take 10 minutes out, 10-minute break, and just allow Jesus to have that picture of Jesus being the rubber band or maybe a good holy hug, whatever picture allows you to sense God's work in your life to hold you together. And so I want you to be a Jesus follower because Jesus created you and wants you to be part of his perfect design. And because Jesus sustains us and can hold you together. And when I talk about those two things, it's kind of crazy to say, why is it then that more people aren't actively following Jesus? And I think the honest answer is, there's a lot of people who are convinced that God's mad at them. God is mad at them. And if you've been taught much about the Christian faith, at some point, maybe quite a few points, you've been taught that God punishes people that do bad things. Which is true, but it is a very small part of the truth, and really, it misses the whole reason we have the New Testament. We have the Gospels that tell about Jesus' life, and the letters that describe how that is Jesus' life affects us today. And all those are designed to tell us a very different, holistic picture, big picture of who God is. And not that he's just the God that punishes bad people. But look at verse 21, which is another marvelous verse. Verse 22. Now Christ has reconciled you, or God reconciled you, by Christ's body, through Jesus' death, that he might present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. And so, the reality is that our assumptions that God was not necessary to our lives caused a breach, caused a gap, caused an alienation from God. But God's been doing everything he can, literally, everything he can. He sacrificed everything he could in order to reconcile you, to bring you back into his fellowship and back into his perfect design. So that the unifying message of the New Testament is that God's no longer just a judge, or even really primarily a judge. He's that, yes. But the bigger picture, the New Testament says, this is what we want you to know. God is sacrificing himself, sacrificing everything he has to rebuild his connection to you. He's rebuilding the connection to you, offering a bridge, building a bridge, not to nowhere, but building a bridge to your where, through the death of Jesus on the cross. In a split second, you can go from having the world's strongest force work against you to having the world, universe's strongest power working for you. The power of God, your decision, in a split second, from working against you to working for you, because it says the cross is the place where Jesus did everything that God can do, and it worked. Our problem, of course, is that our behavior grieved God. We've seen that already. And so the preliminary news is that God is heartbroken. God is heartbroken when our actions don't reflect his original plan. I had a friend, one of those type A people, that always told everyone else around him what they should do. And when we didn't do things exactly the way he said, I loved his response. He said, you know, I'm not mad at you. I'm just disappointed. And I think sometimes maybe that would be a way we could think about God. Is the times when we sin, the times when we step out of God's plan, it's not God gets mad at us. It's, oh, good, now I've got an excuse to punish you. I think God's disappointed, he's grieved, he's heartbroken, because he said, you know, the person that's going to suffer the consequences of your actions, not me, it's you. We thought we could ignore God. We assumed we could ignore God and life would be okay. We assumed we could ignore God and life would be okay. You know, I found that didn't work for me in the chemistry lab. In the chemistry lab, we were given this long list of things to do for a chemistry experiment. You ever had chemistry? You go into the chemistry lab and there'd be all this really complicated equipment. At least it's complicated for someone that ended up being a pastor. But it looked really complicated, and there was a list of instructions from the teacher. You do these 15 things, and when you're done, all this weird stuff is going to smell like pumpkin or peach. Or you do all the stuff, and all of a sudden, magically, right at 13 seconds, all the gases will turn into liquid. Or it'll turn from white into blue. And we were told what the results would be, and this list of 15 things. You know, most of those things didn't seem to be all that important to me. And a lot of them were pretty boring, especially the ones about waiting 5 minutes before you do the next step. And I go, surely 3.5 minutes is going to be enough. 3.5 minutes is a long time. And pretty much every chemistry lab that I did, I found a better way to do it than what the instructions said. I mean, this is honest, this is not preacher story, this is the truth. I didn't get a very good grade in chemistry. Because if you don't follow the instructions, you don't get the results. You know, my friend Dell found out that just because you assume something about a car doesn't mean you can change the results of what happened when you act contrary to the way the car was designed. And it's that way in life too. You can assume whatever you want to about yourself, and you can assume whatever you want to about life and about why all life is horrible to you because of other people's faults. You can assume that as long as you want to. But assuming things about life that aren't true from God's standpoint doesn't change the fact it's going to have negative consequences. The good news is that because Jesus died on the cross, you can accept that offer that Jesus made through his death to be restored to him, to accept his forgiveness. In a split second, you can go from having the world's strongest power work against you to have the world's strongest power working for you. Probably more accurately to say, from resisting the world's strongest force, God, resisting the world's strongest force, to accepting help from the world's strongest force. God's not at all interested in trying to punish you. He's a lot more interested in trying to save you. But we need to accept the invitation. We need to accept the invitation. There's nothing you can do on your own. This is, once again, the story of both the Old Testament and the New Testament. Everything in our Bible is saying, working together, saying, you just can't do it on its own. At that point, when you first assumed you could live without God, you created a severe root level problem. And the only thing that's going to solve that is a severe root level solution. And that severe root level solution is called Jesus' death on the cross. Colossians 1 says that Christ died for you willingly. God died for you willingly. And it also says that's the second great act in the story of God. The first great act is that God created the world. From God's standpoint, the next great act that he did was having Jesus, God himself, die for us on the cross. And in such, Jesus did everything necessary to be restored to God and to his great design. All that we need to do is to accept that. And so Jesus, this morning, is waiting for you. We're going to have another time if you can come to the altar, but what we're really looking for is for those who aren't sure, or maybe those who know for sure that they've never really accepted that gift. A lot of people say, no, I've been around the church a long time, all my life, but I've never really made a time when I switched my allegiance from thinking I could just assume I'm better off on my own. I've never made the commitment to say, I'm going to be a follower of Jesus, I'm going to accept the gift, not because I'm good enough, but because he's loving enough. And so, if you would close your eyes, and we're just going to go into a time when I'm encouraging folks to say, you know, have I accepted that gift? Was there a time in my life when I moved out of that assumption that I could do things better on my own? When I said, no, I'm going to accept not only Christ's forgiveness, but also I'm going to start living according to God's plan and allowing his Holy Spirit to give me strength to do the things he called me to do. Have I made that change of life yet? And here's the prayer. It's a great prayer. If you've prayed this prayer 100 times, you can pray it again just to reaffirm it. If you're praying it the first time, it makes an eternal difference. The prayer goes like this. Dear Lord, I know that you created the world and gave it a perfect design. And I admit, I've tried to live life my own way. And I'm suffering as a result. Thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross so that my sins can be forgiven and I can live in harmony with you again. And so today, right now, this morning, in this building, at Livestream, at my home, or out in the woods, today, right now, I make you my Lord and Savior. And I give you thanks for the joy of salvation that you are giving to me right now. Because I am praying in Jesus' name. Amen. So our worship team has a great song that will reinforce the message. And as we stand, if you want to have an opportunity to visit with me or one of our church leaders about the change that you know you need to make in your spiritual life, come up to the altar. We'd love to visit with you, pray for you, and to experience entering in to God's joy and His peace.
Same old road for miles and miles. focusing on the things that are getting you down. But now we are focusing on Jesus, who lives in the moment. He is with us today. And our chains are gone. We have freedom in Him. We have freedom in Jesus. You know what Pastor Derek used to say? If you want freedom, what's the answer? The answer is always Jesus. Let's sing this song. 2, 3, 4.
Seats, there's a little prayer request or my decision cards. We'd love for you to fill those out and drop those off as you leave. Also, this morning we're going to pray for the offering for those in-house. You can drop them off as you leave. For you out there online, if you want to give, again, you can come by to the church office or you can just send that in. But we want to pray for this morning. But one thing that it's kind of funny. When you were doing the clap thing, it made me think of a T-Rex. A T-Rex could never do that. It'd be like, sorry, that's just where my mind goes. I've been thinking about that for like a half hour over there. But I want to pray for this morning's offering, and then we'll just be dismissed. Lord, we are just so thankful to come and to be in your presence. Lord, we are thankful that you are a chain breaker. Lord, it doesn't matter if it's depression, anxiety, fear, Lord, you break those chains. Those have no hold over us. Lord, it is by your love that we have overcome those things. We are so thankful to be in your presence this morning. Lord, as we go out this week, we ask that you just help us to be followers of Christ. Not necessarily, as Pastor said, just a label of a Christian, Lord, but truly a follower of Christ. The people can look at us and go, there's someone that follows Jesus' teachings. There's someone that loves when nobody else loves. Lord, we pray for that this morning. We just pray this in your name. Amen. So at this time, we're going to dismiss from the Facebook. You guys are dismissed.